See everyone back this evening. Hope you have had a good afternoon. If you were watching the Chiefs game, it was a pretty good afternoon. Sort of a squeaker there. Heard them say that was twice in this season that a game has been won on an interception run back from a extra point attempt. Sort of unusual. So anyway, for what it's worth, it's kind of exciting at that point. It was kind of exciting, too, when we came to the church building this evening. We got here early because I had an appointment early, and then found out there were people all over the building with various meetings going on. There was a meeting in the library for something. There was a meeting, I don't know where they went for evangelism, but they were meeting somewhere, and we were back in room 6 doing some stuff. So there was someone that took over my office and had a meeting in there. Just lots of stuff going on, lots of people involved, and lots of people willing to get here at an odd hour on a Sunday afternoon and make sure these things happen. And that is a part of the excitement of being in this congregation. We're excited by that, and we thank everyone for their participation in those things. I'm looking around to see, is Matt Fouch, is he in here somewhere? There he is, Matt back there. Matt and his son Carter, they want to be considered part of this congregation. So we welcome Matt to us and Carter with him. We're glad to have them. So be sure to meet Matt if you haven't met him already. Recently we had a little group of sermons. I don't know, I've just called them in my notes and records, dealing with some tough ones. We talked about role of just straight suffering and the hardships that come our way in life. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about dealing with just the more mundane, the frustrations of life. Tonight, we're going to look at some hard choices, things where it's not really tragedy in our life, but where we get some answers from God that aren't the easy ones, not necessarily the pleasant ones. I want to start by telling you the story of a runaway slave. Many years ago, in a faraway land, there was a slave. We're going to call him Simus. Simus worked for an honest, decent master, but he still yearned to be free. Then one day, Simus saw a golden opportunity to escape to freedom. He seized his chance. His escape was successful. Excuse me. His escape was successful, and he quickly put as much distance between his master and himself as he possibly could. Simus, I should tell you, was not a Christian at the time of his escape. But at some point in his new life of freedom, he met a missionary and heard the gospel. He believed in Christ, repented as best he could with what he knew at the time, and was baptized into Christ. He made a sincere effort to live a proper Christian life. And then one day, talking with the missionary who had studied with him, the question of his escape from slavery came up. And then there was also this matter of some money that he had pilfered from his master to finance the escape. And Simus came to the conclusion that in his case, repentance required that he return to his master, he forfeit his freedom, and accept whatever punishment his master decided to inflict upon him, which according to the laws of the land, could even be death. He was a babe in Christ, new convert. His sins were forgiven, but he had run away, he had stolen from his master, and he believed he had to go back. If you had been Simus, would you have gone back? And maybe more difficult, if he had come to you for advice, would you have suggested such a demanding, unpleasant, even dangerous plan of action? None of us believes that slavery is an acceptable social arrangement, but we're not being asked to legislate social justice in this case. We're being asked by a young Christian to help that young Christian do the right thing, whatever the cost. Well, you figured out by now that Simus is only this slave's nickname. His full name is Onesimus. Onesimus, if you want. Actually, we call him Onesimus. He is the slave that the Apostle Paul converted in Rome. And Paul, no doubt, played a role in that decision to reunite with his master Philemon. Let's read just a few verses from Paul's letter to Philemon, sort of get some background here. Philemon chapter 1, in case you're interested, verses 10 through 14. I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains, who once was unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me. I'm sending him back. You therefore receive him. That is my own heart, whom I wish to keep with me, that on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. But without your consent I wanted to do nothing, that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. Regardless of our opinions about slavery, Paul and Onesimus agreed that Onesimus had to return to his master. And Onesimus returned willingly because he wanted to do what was right. He wanted to do the right thing. He wanted salvation more than he wanted even earthly freedom. Pretty heavy price to pay. None of us are slaves in the sense that Onesimus was, but we all face situations for which there are no easy choices. There are times when, like Onesimus, doing the right thing is not synonymous with doing the easy thing. Doing the right thing may cost time, it might cost some effort, it might cost a lot of money. Doing the right thing may be emotionally difficult, it might be embarrassing. Doing the right thing may purify our souls, but it might create some significant negative physical consequences. It was not easy. Think about it. It was not easy for Onesimus to make that trip from Rome clear back to Colossae in Asia Minor. Do you think he looked forward to facing Philemon and saying, I'm back, do what you want with me? Was it fun to be free at last and now forfeit that freedom? How many times after he left Rome and before he reached Colossae was he tempted to disappear again where neither Philemon nor Paul could find him? I've never counseled a runaway slave. But I've had people ask for help in making difficult decisions about doing the right thing. And in those situations, I like to find simple, pleasant solutions that don't hurt too much. The problem is that sometimes there are no simple, pleasant, easy solutions that are also faithful to God solutions. Sometimes forgiveness and salvation come quickly, but the scars of sin heal slowly. The Bible gives us numerous and some impressive examples of people who had to face hard, unpleasant solutions to spiritual problems. The aftermath of David's sin with Bathsheba is one of those examples. His conduct was truly horrible. He committed adultery with Bathsheba. He conspired to cover up that sin by murdering her husband. And then he married her thinking that he had gotten away with it with no adverse consequences. But at some point, God sent his prophet Nathan to confront David about the matter, to at least let him know it hadn't gone all that unnoticed. Nathan's visit was either during Bathsheba's pregnancy or shortly after the child was born. I'm not sure if we even tell which. To his credit, when confronted, David sincerely repented. And as a result, God forgave him. In 2 Samuel 12, verse 13, we read, "Then David said to Nathan, 'I have sinned against the Lord.' And Nathan said to David, 'The Lord has also put away your sin. You shall not die.'" Which, being put to death, was a potential sentence for either, take your pick, for the adultery or for the murder. But just because David repented and God forgave him doesn't mean that there were no earthly consequences for David to face. There were at least two long-lasting consequences that David still had to endure, even though spiritually he was forgiven. 2 Samuel 12, verse 10, God informed David that the sword shall never depart from your house because you have despised me. Up until that point, David's career had gone, at least his personal life had gone fairly smoothly. Yes, there have been times when Saul was trying to kill him, but things had gone fairly well. His reign had gone fairly well. His family situation seemed to be all right. But from that point on, David's family was repeatedly plagued with palace intrigue, with rebellions, with all kinds of infighting, assassinations, you name it. The bad stuff was there from this point forward. And in addition, the child born to Bathsheba would get sick and die. 2 Samuel 12, 14 says that because by this deed you have given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also who is born to you shall surely die. Certainly, David would have preferred to repent, and by repenting, avoid any negative side effects. He certainly didn't want the child to die. But what he really wanted was to be back in a right relationship with God. So David submitted to God's will. There's no indication that he complained about God's decision. He accepted God's course of action. It was a rough answer God gave him, but David was okay with it. When the Apostle Paul reached the city of Ephesus, some of his converts came from very non-Christian backgrounds. These were not some nice, upstanding people who went to church every Sunday and only needed to make a few adjustments in their doctrinal positions to be all right with God. These were professional sorcerers. They were witches. They were people who practiced spells and mixed potions and served heathen spirits, and they made a lot of money doing it. Conversion for them meant drastic, radical changes in their lives. It meant a change of religion, a change of lifestyle, a change of livelihood. For some people today, accepting the full New Testament teaching about baptism, for example, that is their obstacle to conversion. These folks in Ephesus had to change much more than their understanding of some religious practice. We read a short description of what they did in Acts chapter 19, verses 18 and 19. "And many who had believed came confessing and telling their deeds. Also, many of those who practiced magic brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all, and they counted up the value of them, and it totaled 50,000 pieces of silver." Cost them a lot in the pocketbook to become Christians. While we were living in Europe, I knew a family once whose conversion hurt both their bank account and their reputation. And to understand the story, you need a little bit of information about the European taxation system. Income taxes are quite high, one, and there's a value-added tax on both goods and labor. One of the worst examples of this is a car. You buy a brand new car, you're probably going to pay 25% value added tax on the brand new car. You sell the car 3 years later, it's now a used car, you pay another 18% value added tax on the used value of the car. When that person sells the car 5 years later, they'll pay 18% tax on it again. And at every time down the line, when you have it worked on, you pay value added tax on the parts and also on the labor. So because of this heavy tax burden, it is quite common for craftsmen, such as auto mechanics or plumbers or carpenters, whatever, to bill for only part of the job, and the rest is paid in cash. The customer doesn't pay the value-added tax, and the craftsman doesn't pay the income tax. It's a win-win situation. This family of two or three brothers, I forget just how many were in the family, had a business, indoor tile for kitchens and such, and for outdoor brick, cobblestone, patios, driveways and such. When they became Christians, they decided they could no longer cheat on their taxes. That meant they now submitted bids for the full bill with the full tax load on it. That resulted in them losing a lot of business because now their bids are all higher than their competitors' bids. But then when they filed their income tax returns, their reported income dropped because they had lost a lot of business. But the Belgian IRS didn't believe them. They assumed that they were just hiding income, so they taxed them on what they used to be making and assumed they were still making. So these new Christians lost income because they had lost customers, but paid more taxes because they were thought to have just been cheating. That's not easy, especially for the faith of a brand new Christian. It was hard. At any rate, in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus taught his disciples the basic principles behind some of these hard lessons that were involved in following him. We sing songs like, "Sweet are the promises, kind is the word, dearer far than any message man ever heard." And it ends with the phrase, though, "Where he leads, I'll follow, follow all the way." The portrait that the song paints is true, but it's only part of the story. If we're not careful, we think of following Jesus only in the pleasant circumstances, only mindful of the sweet promises. When or if you picture yourself, when you project back and you picture yourself following Jesus as the early disciples followed Jesus along the roads of Palestine, what does the road look like that you walk with Jesus? To start with, I remind you, it's a road in first century Palestine, so it's not paved. You're not in a car. In your mind, is it hot? Is it cold? Is it raining as you walk down the road with Jesus? Is the road smooth? Is it rocky? Is it level? Is it hilly? Anytime I have ever had that picture in my mind of walking with Jesus around the Holy Land, it was on a smooth, level road on a moderately warm, sunny day. I've never walked with Jesus in my imagination in the rain or, you know, rocky, hilly, dirty, dusty roads. If we follow Jesus, there will be some nice Sunday afternoon strolls in the park. And there will also be some bad roads and bad weather. There will be times when we have to carry a heavy backpack as we walk. But two things will never change. One, we'll never walk alone if we're willing to go where Jesus is leading. And two, the destination will always be worth the journey. With that in mind, let's notice that following Jesus is only the third point in the process that Jesus describes in Matthew 16, verse 24. Remember the context. Jesus has just announced he's going to go to Jerusalem, be arrested, be tortured, be killed. Peter has just contradicted him on that, and that's when Jesus said, "Get behind me, Peter, your thoughts are not the thoughts of God, but those men." Next statement. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." The first point is self-denial. If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. Self-denial is the initial decision that opens the door to the other decisions and actions. Sometimes we make the journey harder than it needs to be because we try to follow Jesus, which is point number three, before we have taken point number one, which is self-denial. And that was Peter's problem in this conversation. Peter was saying, "I'll follow you, Lord, and here's how we're going to do it." He made the journey harder by second-guessing the methods and the route that Jesus had chosen. Self-denial is the pre-commitment to accept the will of God, whatever that may be. We have to study Scripture to know God's will. We have to pray about it to see how it applies to a particular situation. But we no longer have the moral decision about obeying or not obeying, because we've already made that decision. Self-denial says that I will seek to know what the Lord wants, and whatever it turns out to be, that's what I'll do. So that's the first point. Second point is taking up the cross. Taking up our cross is what happens when we accept the results of the self-denial. And here's something we need to clarify about taking up our cross, because that's become sort of something of a cliche in American English and applied to things that aren't exactly what the Bible was talking about when it talks about taking up our cross. In life, everyone has to face some hard times here and there. It might be poor health, it might be financial reversals. That can afflict anyone, whether they are following Christ or not. Facing those challenges has nothing to do with being faithful to Jesus or carrying a cross. Strictly speaking, unavoidable life problems are not what Jesus meant by bearing a cross. Bearing a cross as Jesus bore his cross is the direct result of deciding to follow Jesus. For example, Jesus, he could have said, "Father, I don't want to do what you sent me to do." He could have refused the cross. Bearing the cross was accepting the unpleasant results of his prior decision to be faithful and do his Father's will, whatever it may be. After denying self, and after we accept whatever consequences that decision brings, then we follow Jesus. Self-denial is the decision. Cross-bearing is accepting the consequences of that decision. Following is the action of moving forward on that foundation. As best I can tell, the Bible presents a very balanced view of the blessings and the trials that go with following Jesus. I don't want to leave the impression that the Christian life is a life of total drudgery and bad things that you just have to, you know, suck it up and swallow it. The phrase bearing a cross certainly draws our attention to the challenges and the difficulties that come with following Christ. That is part of it. When we follow wherever Jesus leads, he will lead us through some serious cross bearing. But he also leads us through some wonderful blessings. So there's another side to this portrait. We don't want to get the perception out of balance on either side of that, that it's all roses or that it's all hardship. There's a bit of both. And we take what comes because we've decided to follow Christ. I'm thankful that the Bible doesn't give a sugar-coated description of life in Christ. That would throw us off. As a general rule, very general rule, doing the right thing will usually make life easier and more rewarding. But there will be difficulties that come not just from living, but from following Christ. If we don't expect the challenges, we'll be tempted to run from them. Or we'll think that they are some sort of message from God telling us that we're being punished for doing wrong. And we'll take material blessings when they come as a certain sign of God's approval. The key is to follow Christ with our focus on the final, eternal, ultimate reward. Moses is another example of a person who accepted the price of obedience. Over in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24, it tells us of his willingness to accept the hard answer over the easy one. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he looked to the reward. Moses had lived his childhood and youth years as a prince. It's easy to get used to that kind of life, sort of get addicted to it. He could have continued that way, but he gave up the palace life to free the slaves of Israel. But before he could do that, God thought that he needed some additional preparation that was much less exciting than being the great liberator. Moses thought that he could go from the privileged prince to the acclaimed liberator almost overnight. He soon learned that Israel wasn't ready to follow a prince of Egypt. So he spent 40 years away from both the palace and the people, working as a shepherd. The key to the faithfulness of Moses is found there at the end of verse 26, where it says, "For he looked to the reward." Whatever the ups and downs that he had to face on earth, he knew that the outcome would be worth the wait and worth whatever it cost to get there. He realized that the ultimate reward was not on this earth. That was the same thing that motivated Onesimus when he went back to Colossae to face his master. The ultimate eternal reward was worth the trip and whatever Philemon did to him. That's the perspective that Jesus is presenting in Matthew chapter 16. After he talked about the reality and the necessity of self-denial and cross-bearing, he went on to talk about glory, reward. In verse 27, in the same passage, just the next verse, "For the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works." I'm not sure we always pay a whole lot of attention to that particular verse when we look at this passage. We look at the "get behind me, Satan" part. We may look at the cross-bearing part. But this verse is there too. Living a life of faithful service to God is a bit like the really old cowboy movies. There might be a certain amount of suspense and drama and intrigue and turmoil in the story, but in the end, the good guys in the white hats always win. And in this story, the good guy, Christ, and those with him always win. Jesus bore his cross. That was the ultimate unpleasant consequence of submitting to God's will. He didn't bear the cross because he enjoyed it. It wasn't because he had no choice. It was because he was focused on the result, reward and glory for him and for us. When following Christ down a difficult stretch of road, we have His promise that the road leads to something much better. Christ denied Himself, and as a result, He was confronted with a very unpleasant cross. He then carried His cross, died on His cross, and as a result, conquered death, rose from the grave, and is seated in glory next to His Father. When He invites us to deny self, carry the cross, follow Him, He's leading us to participate, to have a share in the glory of God in heaven. There will be times when doing what is right will not be pleasant. Just repenting of sin can make us extremely uncomfortable. Accepting forgiveness, but still having to live with the earthly consequences can be discouraging. Thought I'd put that behind me. No, there's still things that come with it. Forgiving others, but still feeling the hurt of what they did to us. Not the answer we want when we, oh, it's so great to forgive, but it might still hurt. To endure such crosses, it's imperative that we stay convinced of and focused on that reward. If we are motivated only by what we get out of it or what we expect to get out of it on earth, we will eventually be disappointed. Jesus never promised an easy life. He did promise victory to those who faithfully follow Him. Paul summed it up in Romans chapter 8, verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. If you have not already done so, make the decision to follow Jesus wherever He leads. Accept the blessings and the burdens that follow that decision, knowing that something better than either the blessings or the burdens will be the reward. Confess your faith in Jesus as God's Son. Turn from sin, be baptized for the forgiveness of sin. If you're in Christ but you need the encouragement of the church to be true to your commitment, let us know how we can help. Let's stand, let's sing, respond if you need to.